So good morning, good afternoon, or good evening, and welcome to the first day of the Global Construction Summit 2022. This is brought to you by the Chartered Institute of Building and Global Construction Review. And that's in association with our partners Glodon, Plan Radar, and Trimble Viewpoint. I'm Will Mann, editor of Construction Management magazine, and I'm your chair for the first session today, where we will look at diversity and inclusion, the way forward for construction. Firstly, we're going to take a quick look at the full conference program for the Global Construction Summit, which runs across the next 3 days. So after our first session this morning on diversity and inclusion, this afternoon at 2 p.m. GMT, these are all GMT times, I should say, we will look at building safety and technology around the world. Tomorrow morning, that's 23rd of February at 11 a.m. GMT, we discuss construction clients' evolving priorities. Then in the afternoon session at 2 p.m. GMT, we will look at how to prove the benefits of information management. And we will wrap up on Thursday, 24th of February at 9 a.m. GMT with BIM Beyond 3D, implementing 4D and 5D. And if you haven't done so already, you can register for those other sessions at the link shown, globalconstructionreview.com/global-construction-summit. Okay, so now let's focus on diversity and inclusion, the way forward for construction. So what's in this session's program? Our speakers will provide first-hand experience of construction business leaders' pioneering efforts to open up their organisations to all, including structural changes to make room for underrepresented groups, cultural change to prepare a welcoming workforce, and organisational change to drive continuous improvement. And after all our speakers have presented, there will be a Q&A session. So let me welcome our speakers today. From Australia, Alison Mirams, CEO of Tier 1 construction company, Roberts Co. From the USA, Stacee Barkley, diversity and inclusion lead for US national contractor, DPR Construction. From the United Kingdom, Caroline Gumble, the first female CEO of the Chartered Institute of Building. And later on, we will be joined for the Q&A by Sandy Rhys-Jones OBE, who is Vice President of the Chartered Institute of Building, and Rod Sweet, Editor of Global Construction Review. Before we crack on, there's a little bit of housekeeping. Please use the Q&A function rather than the chat function to ask questions during presentations. You can pose a question as yourself or anonymously. Our speakers may answer questions using the Q&A function during the webinar. Any unanswered or important questions will be addressed in the Q&A session after the speakers have finished. And this webinar is recorded and will be available on demand later today. Right, so that's enough of that. Let's start. I'm going to stop sharing my screen now and I'm going to welcome Alison. Alison, if you could please start sharing your screen and unmute yourself. You have. Great.
Thank you, Will. And we'll just get this up onto full screen. So hopefully you can all see that. As Will said, I'm Alison Mirams, CEO of a construction company in Sydney, Australia. Hopefully my internet stays. We're having a big rain event at the moment. So please bear with me if the internet is a bit jittery. Just to set the scene for you on the construction industry in Australia, men in construction are 53% more likely to die by suicide than any other Australian employed male. Under the Work Health and Safety Act, people conducting a business undertaking have a duty to protect workers from psychosocial risks as well as physical risks. And the best way to do this is by designing work systems and workplaces to eliminate or minimise risks to psychological health, monitoring the health of workers and workplace conditions, and consulting with workers. The industry suffers from very high presenteeism, very high divorce rates, very high suicide rates. We only have 18.1% females in management staff positions, professional positions, and only 2% of trades are female. So with this in mind, when we were tendering for the Concord Hospital redevelopment, it's a government project, we said to Health Infrastructure, who were the client, you of all people can't allow someone to die from suicide caused by workplace stress when we are building a hospital to make people better. It's not right. And to their absolute credit, they said, yes, what do we do? So in our tender, we submitted two programs. The first was a six-day program working Monday to Saturday, like we do on all projects in Australia. And the second one was a five-day program, only working Monday to Friday and giving a weekend to every worker. The five-day program added 10 weeks of time. If I just initially took out Saturday out of the program as a working day, it added 4 months. And then we said, there are things we can do between 3 and 5 in the afternoon. So instead of working 7 till 3, we'd work 7 till 5. But clearly if it was a concrete pour, it had to go to the next day. So it added 10 weeks of time and it was 1.2% of cost for the additional preliminaries to run the program. And a lot of people say to me, what's the extra cost? But what's the cost of a life? So we've now finished the project. It's complete. When we completed during construction, we had the University of New South Wales undertake an independent study for us, and they studied 180 workers, they studied 12 next of kin, and they studied my staff as well. And what we found was workers are reporting decreased fatigue, improved work-life balance, improved quality of life, and improved family relationships. They're spending more time with their kids. They're taking their kids to Saturday sport. Many said, I can play sport myself, which is the great Australian dream, to play sport. They felt more motivated to come to work on a Monday because they felt rested. And if you think about that, when you have a long weekend, you feel like you've had a holiday because you had an extra day of leave. We are giving workers an extra 6 weeks of leave per annum by having Saturdays off. Yes, it's not in one block, but it is a huge amount of rest that they are getting in a year that they don't normally get. And one of my crane drivers did the maths for me and he said, for every 8 years that I work 5 days a week, I get an entire year of time back with my family. So if you put that through a 40-year career, that's an extra 5 years of time you get with your family. The initial concern that we had about reduced pay and less overtime, the workers have positively looked at that and said, but I've got a better life. And not many of them want to return to working 6 days a week. Subcontract owners are saying to us, the site is better planned, it's safer, it's more professional. There's less aggression and there's more harmony on the project, and it's very visible when you walk around. It's a very happy, harmonious site. And when you're rested, you know, when you're constantly tired and stressed, you're asked to do something and it's just explosion because they can't cope with it. But when they're rested, if someone says, can you help me with this? They're saying, yeah, no problem. Of course I can. Next of kin are reporting a distinct change in the behaviour and wellbeing of their partners. They feel like they don't have to walk on eggshells around them at home. They also, when the partners are working full-time, working 6 days a week, the next of kin are doing all of the caring roles for the children. And so the partners, and they are largely women, are not getting a break because they're not getting a day off to rest, because on Sunday that's dad's day to rest because he's tired. They walk on eggshells around them and mum's not getting a break. They said they would like greater flexibility in their partner's work schedule and consistency in the hours so that they can plan if dad could do drop off or dad could do pick up occasionally. Because women, because of our working hours, women are turning down employment. They are turning down opportunities in their own careers, promotions, because they know they have to do all the caring for the children. Now, if you think about that, the construction industry in Australia is the third largest industry. So not only are we poor at bringing women into the industry, we are poor at retaining them. But by our working patterns, we are stopping women from working in the economy in all roles because they're at home caring for kids. You can see a quote here on the side, it's not fair on me because I'm the one who's working reduced hours. And if our marriage doesn't make it to the end, then I come out with less super, less income, and he's the one who's worked and has got the bigger nest egg. It's the whole gender inequality. And that's what we've seen. So we really need to change the working hours. We haven't just focused on Project 5 though. We set up our company. Our company's only 5 years old. We came out of the big end of town, all the big contractors. And we said, we've got a blank sheet of paper. How do we do it differently? So we said, we want the right clients. If we're not culturally aligned to the client, we decline to tender. I want the right people. We do have a no dickheads policy because if someone's not right culturally in your business, they will destroy your culture. So we have made the decision, if they weren't right, to take them out of the business early. We have also employed into pay bands, and that's important to make sure that we don't get inequality in pay between males and females. We've got very experienced design managers, and our executive design managers are at the same level as our project managers, because if we don't get design right, we can't procure. If we can't procure, we can't build. And that's when you get that crunch at the back end of a job, when you see jobs working 5, 6, 7 days a week constantly, because we've lost time at the front end. So instead of crunching the back end, we're trying to fix the root cause, and that's to get people in design at the front who focus on the right elements of design at the right time so we can build. We've made a big investment into technology. We do our inductions online. We built an app so that we can very quickly give everyone access to all the contact details for all the supervisors on site, both ours and subcontractors. It's got the weather on there for them. It's got the permits on there for them as well, so that they can do everything they need to online. And it also gives them the pre-start. So if they come to site late, we can push the pre-start to them so they know what's going on the site each day and they can work safely. We streamlined our procedures. We've streamlined our contracts. The biggest contract we have is 24 pages, and it says we will be fair and reasonable, so that we can get back to relationship contracting, which was so successful 20 years ago. We pay everyone in 20 days. Now, under the security of payments legislation in New South Wales, that's mandated, but a lot of contractors don't do it. So we are very focused on paying everyone in 20 days. We have signage at the front of our sites, which you would have seen on a prior slide, that says, thank you to our subcontractors and stakeholders. We can't build without you. When you walk down the road and you see a construction site, you typically only see the head contractor's signage. But on our site, you'll see a thank you sign. And what that means is the subcontractors walk in the morning, they see their name, they hold their head up high, and they think, huh, that's me. And they feel respected and they feel valued. And then we get better quality, we get better safety, we get a harmonious site. It's a very small, symbolic gesture, but it goes a long way. And then we really believe in IQ and EQ, which is your intelligence and your emotional intelligence. But if you don't have your DQ, which is your decency quotient, you can still be not a nice person. Your emotional intelligence just lets you know you're not a nice person, but you don't care fundamentally. If you have your decency quotient, you won't be a nasty person. So we believe in IQ, EQ, and DQ, and just behave as a decent human being. So if I can say to you, COVID-19 was terrible. It was really hard. It was hard to operate. It was hard to build, but it had a silver lining. It put the construction industry into the largest and fastest experiment on flexible working, and it was a resounding success. We sent everyone home. We went into lockdown, but we still managed to build. We turned FaceTime on. We had Zooms. We had Teams. And it proved that you don't have to be full-time on a construction site. You can be part-time. You can work from home. We've seen improved productivity when every worker enjoys a weekend. So whilst initially it added 10 weeks to our program, now we are not adding any time. We are just working 5 days a week because we're getting the efficiency from the workers. I would encourage you to talk to clients and contractors about the systemic issues in the industry. Don't ignore them. When I say to a client and they say to me, we need you to work safely, and I say, okay, let's talk about mental health, let's talk about suicides, they have no idea what the statistics are. So we need to not bury them. We need to put them front and centre and talk about them and resolve them. Recruit women as a core business strategy. So the D&I strategy in our business is run by me as the CEO. It's not an HR initiative. It's not an add-on on the side. It is absolutely core business. And one of the things I really believe in is that if we change the working conditions for men, women will benefit. It's not a women's issue. Flex is not a women's issue. And time with family is not a women's issue. It's a people issue. So we need to change the working conditions for men and women will benefit. So I'll leave it there and I'll hand back to Will.
Thank you. Thank you very much for that. That was excellent, Alison. Okay, we're moving on now to Stacey. So Stacey, if I can ask you to unmute yourself and start sharing your screen.
Absolutely. Thank you. And Alison, that was absolutely brilliant. That's a tough presentation to follow. You all have just done some amazing, amazing work. So bear with me for a moment while I just get my technology. Hopefully you're able to see my screen. Okay. Wonderful. Just bear with me for just a moment. There we go. Thank you so much. My name is Stacee Barkley. I'm the Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion Leader for DPR Construction. And I'm delighted to share a little bit of what our journey has been like to increase representation for the traditionally underrepresented groups, prepare a welcoming workforce, and drive continuous improvement. For DPR, when we think about our global social responsibility, it is about fulfilling one of our vivid descriptions about being integral and indispensable in our communities. It's about being a strong global citizen that develops a sense of belonging, environmental stewardship, and community engagement. Our four pillars of GSR are people, creating a more diverse, equitable, and inclusive environment, which I have the delight and pleasure of leading, partners, maximizing opportunities for diverse businesses, planet, building a healthier environment for the people and planet, and philanthropy, building possibilities for the under-resourced. And for us, these pillars are inextricably linked to one another. It is my belief that diversity, equity, and inclusion have been a part of the fabric of DPR since our inception nearly 32 years ago. Doug, Peter, and Ron, our founders, established the value of increasing women and people of color across the organization and at all leadership levels. I say value and not priority intentionally, as priorities change, but values typically do not. It is with this intention, but also driven organically by our culture, that both have happened. That said, we fully acknowledge the need to increase the pace with respect to diversity, not just as an organization, but as an industry. With this in mind, when I joined DPR 2.5 years ago, it was by the company's design to bring focus and intentionality to embedding the practice and principles of diversity, equity, and inclusion throughout the employee lifecycle and across the employee experience. One of the first things we did was to establish our commitment and vision for what DEI means for us as a company and how it aligns with our overarching mission. And our mission in the context of our commitment to DEI is a workforce that reflects the rich diversity of the communities in which we live, work, serve, and build, and a workplace where everyone is encouraged and empowered to bring their best authentic selves and thrive. Our mission and the DEI vision ultimately serves our commitment to hire, inspire, develop, and grow all of our people. That is the organizational imperative that informs creating and executing our DEI strategy. It's a journey of discovering where we are, defining where we want to be, designing the roadmap to get us there, and deploying the tactics that will get us there just in time. My philosophy has been to begin with limitless possibilities if time, money, and people capacity were not limiting factors, what could be imagined, and then value engineer from there. I am a firm believer that we are not limited by what we don't know, but by what we do, as we tend to gravitate towards that. It's easy to rely on how we have done things. It's familiar and frequently comfortable, but progress typically does not come without some or a lot of disruption or discomfort. And we can't allow these to be barriers. Part of our messaging and communication about diversity, equity, and inclusion is awareness and education to make sure everyone knows DEI is about all of us, not any one of us. Frequently, when we think of diversity, we think of gender and ethnicity, but diversity is not monolithic. It's actually more of a kaleidoscope. This image depicts all of the different parts that make up our own identity and how we see the world. This image and the quote speaks to the idea that we all have differences that makes each of us unique and yet the same. I'm not different from you, I'm different like you. The saying, you can't judge a book by its cover. The key takeaway is that we are all diverse, and some of that diversity is frequently unseen. Depending on the population, 62 to 96% of disabilities are unseen. Though measured differently, diversity is very similar. There are some protected demographics where it's important to focus time, energy, and resources. But holistically speaking, what this shows is that even in the seemingly most homogeneous of groups, there is still diversity. So we also felt it crucial to communicate about the connection between psychological safety and physical safety. The words we use can make all the difference in whether someone feels like they're a part or a part. Feeling a part or belonging reduces harmful distractions that can lead to safety incidences. And Alison spoke very eloquently to this. Psychological safety is also important for overall mental health. According to the CDC, construction has the highest suicide rate across all industries. The suicide rate in construction is about 4 times greater than our national average, and 5 times greater than that of all other construction fatalities combined. Cultivating a culture of inclusion and belonging that reinforces psychological safety and security impacts mental health as well as physical well-being. We have all likely heard the quotes, if you're not keeping score, it's just practice, or people manage what gets measured. As the landscape for talent is becoming increasingly competitive, talent analytics are critical components to any DEI strategy. We need to know where we are to plan for where we want to be. This applies internally, relative to the industry, and within the broader ethos of organizations. When we consider talent analytics through the lens of DEI, diversity is representation, hiring and recruiting, equity, compensation, promotions, career mobility, and performance measurements, inclusion, sentiment, attrition, retention, and learning impact. This data allows us to identify access points to diverse talent, identify barriers to opportunities and access, and inform growth and development opportunities. The two quotes that hold me accountable are, we don't always rise to our goals, but fall to our systems, and the company's culture is the worst behavior a leader is willing to tolerate. The former means we must have policies, practices, and transparency. The latter, that we must pay attention to the quiet saboteurs of DEI, things like microaggressions, unconscious bias, and a lack of psychological safety. It also means accepting that not everyone is ready or willing to be on the DEI journey. It's helpful to meet people where people are, but not stay there. Some people will self-select out, and others may need to be invited. Part of our journey and that of affecting industry change has been collaborating with others. In the space of being better humans, there is nothing proprietary. Recognizing that more could be done collectively than individually, in 2020, in the aftermath of the murder of George Floyd, a group of general contractors came together and formed Time for Change, with the single purpose of identifying ways to advance DEI in the construction industry. And from this group, Construction Inclusion Week was born. This past October 2021, the inaugural Construction Inclusion Week took place. With the theme Building Foundation for Inclusion, there were sub-themes for each day around leadership, commitment, and accountability, unconscious bias, supplier diversity, job site culture, community engagement, and philanthropy. With resources to support each day and theme, like toolbox talks for job sites, table talks for offices, coloring books for at-home activities, and additional supplemental external resources like recommended readings, podcasts, and movies. I'm thrilled to say we've begun preparations for this year's Construction Inclusion Week, which will be October 17th to the 21st. The theme and supporting materials, information, and resources will be coming out soon. So I'd like to end where I began. To increase representation of traditionally underrepresented or marginalized groups, prepare a welcoming workforce, and drive continuous improvement means challenging ourselves to acknowledge where we are, imagine a different future, invest in that future, and partner with others. Thank you.
Thank you, Stacey. That was terrific. Thanks very much. So I'm now going to hand over to Caroline. Welcome, Caroline. And she is going to speak direct to camera.
Thank you very much, Will. And my goodness, I always worry when I come to these sorts of events. This is an investment in your life, in your work time or private time. And I certainly, over my career, have often thought, well, yes, it's great. I know all this stuff. I believe in this stuff. I understand how important it is. But there are all these other people who are influencers, business leaders, and I would love them to be hearing this too. And hearing out what Alison and Stacey has just presented, you know, if you've got people like that in your life, whether it's your work life or private life, just get them to listen in on those two presentations. And I'm sure it really will convince them that D&I is a core business issue. I think it's very, very evident. And I'll just sort of focus on that to begin with. Let me go back to the global credit crunch from the period 2008 to 2010. There has been a shortfall in the UK construction workforce, with vacancies outstripping the supply of skilled labour. The Construction Industry Training Board have put some figures on it. This was pre-pandemic. It was estimated that we need 160,000 new recruits by 2023. That's just to keep up with demand. Now, this is mirrored in many, many other countries. So, for example, in the USA, the Home Builders Institute reported just last year that the industry needs to recruit more than 2 million extra people in the next 3 years to meet rising demand. In Germany, a third of construction firms reported problems finding skilled staff in September last year. Australia's Housing Industry Association have said that the industry is experiencing its most significant skill shortage since tracing began in 2003. Now, this is a shortfall that Alison does reference in a recent article that she wrote for Global Construction Review, and I do recommend that to you. So for me, this is a real core business issue. It isn't a soft subject. It's business and it's meaningful and it's hard. Unfortunately, I've had my team looking at data in the last few weeks preparing for this event, and it's just so disheartening. There is a real lack of robust global data on the construction workforce, and we haven't been able to source figures on construction recruitment or workforce shortfall for many, many countries. So that says a lot to me in its own right. Now, there are many reasons for the shortfall in skilled labour, and one of the main ones being ageing workforce within construction, and in my view, another being the poor record we have on recruiting people from groups which are currently underrepresented. But let's look at the wider economy and why a focus on the construction workforce really does matter. The CIOB report, The Real Face of Construction, that we published in 2020, outlined the true value of our industry to the UK economy. The construction industry, according to the narrow Office for National Statistics definition of construction, accounts for about 6% of the UK's economic output. However, if you actually include architects, engineers, quantity surveyors, and manufacturers dedicated to the industry, the suggestion is that our industry accounts for around 12% of the UK's economic output. So by not recording in that sort of way, it diminishes to the public, but actually when you analyse it, it's 12% of the UK's economy. Now, I know I'm talking from a UK-centric point of view here, and I think the stats are not too dissimilar elsewhere. The other thing that this report, The Real Face of Construction, notes, that construction accounts for about 7% of all jobs in the UK. Again, they are pre-pandemic numbers. Giving more of a global perspective, the Oxford Economics Future of Construction report from last year states that the period between 2020 and 2030, growth in construction will remain a major driver for the global economy. In short, we work in an industry which is a key driver of the economy, in which demand will probably always outstrip supply globally, and for which we have really good, high quality, high well-paid jobs. There is no doubt construction has an important role to play in our economic recovery as we now emerge from the pandemic. This leads us to look at opportunities to meet the needs of the industry and meet the changing needs and demands of our society. The construction industry must attract the best talent possible. Therefore, we need more focus on the groups from which they are not effectively recruiting. We need more focus on bringing in women, people from communities that face racial discrimination, people with disabilities, and other underrepresented groups. So you're hearing many repeat themes here. I'm sure many of you are aware of the figures. I think they're quite shocking. And if you've heard them before, they will bear repeating. In the UK, women make up around 12 to 13% of construction industry workers, with only 1 to 2% of those being on-site roles. The figures for ethnic minorities are worse. People from ethnic minority backgrounds make up about 6% of the construction industry workforce. And to put this into context, according to government data, 13% of the population in the UK comes from an ethnic minority background. We know these figures are mirrored in many countries, the USA, Canada, Australia, and New Zealand, for example. Although the figures from Australia mentioned earlier by Alison seem to be a slight improvement on where we are in the UK. Disappointingly, despite our research efforts, we found it hard to source figures on the numbers of men and women in construction for many countries, which won't help in delivering our objective to improve diversity globally. The benefits of increasing diversity in the workforce are numerous. And my goodness, Alison, that was a fantastic presentation. And I really do think many on this call today will have found that very inspiring. I hope it's widely understood, not least because the business benefits are so clear, but the motivations for doing so in an industry in desperate need of new recruits is even more pressing. It is essential that improving diversity and inclusion is tackled and that initiatives around this are openly supported by industry leaders. To be clear, box ticking will not cut it. Progressive and positive policies and behaviours in this area need to be established and have real commitment behind them. And Alison, I loved your no dickhead policy. I've not heard that before, but wow, that's really, really inspiring. I know this work won't be easy, but it is necessary. And I have to say, Alison, you look as if you're really enjoying your job, and I think your company will be a marvellous company to work in. That you've really respected your staff, and I'm just so inspired by that. Last year, CIOB appointed an EDI transformation lead, reporting directly to myself as CEO. That is a clear signal regarding the strategic importance of this post. My ambition is that this investment supports the required culture change within our membership, leading to an inspired culture in the wider industry. And only tomorrow, I will be meeting with other CEOs of other professional institutes so that we can actually collaborate together on this very important topic. It's too big for any one of the institutes to go alone. We have to work together on this. And I'm pleased to share one of the outputs from our focus on diversity and inclusion. And this is our EDI special report and charter. Now, I don't know if you're going to see that, but just to prove I've got a copy and I've read it many times. The charter was created to be practical, outlining behaviours we can all work towards to make our industry more inclusive. The five headline behaviours are: one, show leadership; two, make a plan; three, shape the culture; four, be transparent; and five, be accountable. Now, if you haven't seen the report, do have a look at it. It's available free on our website. I believe Will or Justin will share a link with you all. I urge any of you who are employers, or if you're not, ask your employer to sign up to the charter. Greet it as an opportunity to show the leadership I mentioned earlier and has been mentioned by Stacey and Alison. I know many within our industry already show leadership on driving diversity and inclusion. Alison and Stacey are both superb examples of leaders in this respect. The charter is an opportunity to promote your commitment to making the industry a more attractive place to work. It sends a clear message, not just to your existing employees, but to potential future recruits and clients too. And I have to say, when I go out and meet our members, I meet some who say, look, I'm going to finish this big project and I might be relocating back to the UK, or I'm looking to go and work maybe in Dubai for a while. Can you advise us, you know, who are the good employers? Who are the employers who are really living diversity and inclusion, not just ticking boxes? So, you know, we have a generation now of a workforce who really do take it seriously and will make their future career decisions on the culture and attitude from the big employers and smaller employers, obviously. We talk about changing the culture of the sector, but we must recognise the culture won't change until we have embraced some real diversity. We must be clear that we need and want an industry with people from different backgrounds, different personalities, different experiences, different perspectives, the whole spectrum of different. Diversity, to me, goes beyond the protected legal definitions. Different is good and will deliver better buildings for all of society. If all of society is represented in the industry creating those buildings. I also want to touch on something which is timely and I think relevant to the debate on opportunities to improve inclusion and something my fellow panelists have already talked about. There are changing work patterns emerging as a result of many of us having to work remotely. Clearly, there are only a few certain roles within construction for which remote working is an option, but there are many who see this as having accelerated the shift in culture to a more inclusive working practices. And Alison really did demonstrate that today. So if ever there was a time to rethink perceptions around caring responsibilities, work-life balance, and how effectively many roles can be done remotely, it is now. As we've heard, despite assumptions to the contrary, there can also be positive effects for on-site teams and families. Listening to Alison, I must admit I hadn't considered the impact on the wider family of these different and new working practices. I thought that was superb. And I speak as the mother of four grown-up sons, and my goodness, I would have really valued more flexibility in my family scenario. So we do have a need to stagger working patterns to enable socially distant working. Many male construction workers commented to me through the pandemic how they appreciated more flexibility and they did regain very valuable time with their families. Remote working and more flexibility on site are positive steps, but I have come to realise that holding on to the positives we have gained during the pandemic is something that will absolutely require a conscious effort and, again, support and encouragement at a leadership level. So my call to action today: help us present a better image of this important industry and encourage a diversity of people to come into it and thrive as a valued and welcome member of the team. We are a fantastic sector with lots of opportunities for individuals and lots of opportunities to deliver for society. Construction can help in the drive to net zero. It can support social mobility. It can provide meaningful, purpose-driven careers, but it needs to be openly and visibly accessible to everyone. Thank you.
Thank you, Caroline. Nice positive note to end on there. And we will email a link to the CIOB D&I Charter to all attendees after the webinar. Okay, so now let's move on to the Q&A session. And if I can welcome back all of our speakers and introduce our panelists. So we're also now joined by Sandy Rhys-Jones, OBE, Vice President of the Chartered Institute of Building, and Rob Sweet, Editor of Global Construction Review. So we'll move on to questions from attendees in just a moment, but firstly, a question for me, for all our panel. How do you know if an organisation has got their culture right or perhaps needs to do more work on their EDI? And Caroline, if you want to take that first, and then Sandy, Alison and Stacey.
Thank you, Will. Yes, so I think we can apply a real simple measure on this one. Next time you're on a workplace meeting, and that may be virtual, it may be in real life, just look around that screen and or look around that room. And if everybody looks just like you, then I would suggest there's possibly a little bit more to do to improve that diversity in that workplace. So nice and simple from me, but do it as a measure every meeting you go to. And hopefully it will improve. Thank you.
Thank you, Caroline. Sandy. Sorry, Sandy, you're on mute.
There we go, on mute. First, I must say, fantastic presentations, so much in there. Yes, you're quite right, Caroline. Look around. I mean, I've been in the industry so long, I got used to being the only woman in sometimes a conference of 900 people. But one of the most satisfying things I found myself saying when the senior partner of a very large international firm apologized to me for being the only woman at the international partner's dinner, I simply responded by saying how much I was looking forward to telling the company what they needed to do to improve their business performance the next day. That was the reason I was there. So there is a visible thing, but I think there are other questions to ask. And one of the first things I do when I go into a new business or I meet a new business is look at staff churn and staff retention. And both Alison and Stacey talked about this, because we can fill the hopper, we can do these school road shows, but if you get the people in and that pipeline is leaking, you need to find out why and who is leaving. And that will reveal a lot on the EDI issue. I'll stop there, because as you all know, I can go on hatfuls on this.
Thank you. Thank you, Sandy. Alison, over to you.
Look, just on the culture, when you know you've got it right, for me, about a year ago, one of our project teams came to me and said, we've got an issue. This was said, it was said from a foreman to a cadet, that's not okay. And it wasn't me picking it up. It was the project team saying, that's not okay. And they were the ones that said, he's got to go. It's not appropriate. So for me, that was when I said to our exec team, you know what, we've got it right. They're calling it out, not us.
Very good. Very good. Thanks, Alison. Stacey.
Yeah, I will obviously agree with everything everyone has said. The data is so important. We look deeply and richly at who's in the room, who's being asked to offer feedback and contribute to projects. But looking, you know, let your fingers do the walking, seeing the leadership at organizations and what the board looks like and what the senior most leaders of an organization are will tell you where they're at on the journey. A picture is worth a thousand words. And while, as I said earlier, you can't judge all diversity, you know, you can't judge a book by its cover, it can be pretty indicative of where an organization is on the journey.
Thank you, Stacey. Rod, do you want to comment on that at all? And I think you also had a question or two for our panel.
Yes, thanks very much. Brilliant presentations, everybody. Well done. Really exciting. And I wanted to ask Alison, with the Concord Hospital project, did that get attention in Australia, or in New South Wales, or the whole country? And in the media, let's say, or in the industry, and did it have an effect on your ability to recruit more women?
Yes, great question. Yes, it got media. That was from us really talking about it and pushing it. It's interesting, I did an interview on ABC Radio and the commentator introduced it and she said, we're going to talk about something revolutionary today. We're going to talk about how we're changing the construction industry. They're going to work 5 days a week. And I thought, how ludicrous. You know, it sounds like we're doing something incredible. We're still working 5 days a week. A lot of people don't realise the industry actually works 6 or 7. So it's trying to get that message out and say it's not okay. Has it helped recruit? Absolutely. In my experience, and I've been in the industry for 25 years, I have seen a lot of women leave when they've come out of uni, they've started working and they've seen the 6 day week and said, I want to have family one day. I'm going to go and get another career now before I'm too old to change careers. They don't have a partner, they're not pregnant, but they can see the barriers to being a mum and having a career. So we have made it very possible for them to do both. I've got project engineers on our sites that work 3 days a week, 1 day from home, 2 days on site. It works. They're mums. I've got one who's heavily pregnant at the moment, and we've said to her, you know, for your own comfort, you can work from home if you want, full time, no problem. We have 39% females in our staff as a construction company, and they say, I can see I can have a career and I can be a mum. And so absolutely, it is a draw card. I didn't expect it would be. I didn't appreciate it, but it is.
Great. That's fantastic. And Alison, I mean, Stacey, a similar question. I think DPR is a pioneer in establishing a culture that supports equity, diversity and inclusion. And you've been in post for 2.5 years and the company founders are pioneers in thinking about this. Can you comment on the effect that your well-developed EDI approach has had on DPR's ability to recruit and retain people? Because that's such a competitive issue in the industry and in all the countries that are represented here today.
Absolutely. Well, I think at any organization and within any industry, people want to be able to see that there's an opportunity for them to grow and develop and see people who look like them within the organization, across the depth and breadth of an organization, at all levels of an organization. And so for us, and in the interest of transparency, we are still very much on the journey. I don't want to make it sound like we've got it all figured out by any stretch of the imagination. But this idea that cultivating a culture of inclusion and belonging, Alison mentioned it before, where people are actively having those conversations about the right behavior, what is and isn't tolerated, whether it be on a job site or in an office, is hugely important, particularly when you think about women in the industry. And then we can talk about ethnic diversity as well. But from a representation or a recruitment perspective, when it comes to representation, when we go to colleges or trade schools or conferences, it's so important that the people who are attending those events and interacting with the attendees at those events look like the people for whom those events are representing. And so it is a huge recruitment opportunity because, again, we can take lots of opportunities to increase representation across the broad spectrum of diversity, but people want to see themselves. And so I think that's a huge lesson for anyone going to events like that, to just kind of walk away from, do I see myself in the people who are showing up at those events?
Great, thank you.
Okay, Rod, anything more from you, or shall I go on to the Q&As?
Yes, let's hear some of the great questions in the Q&A.
Okay, so Alison, a few people have been asking you about your policy of dealing with, less welcome people. Would you like to say a little bit more about that, for the benefit of the rest of the attendees?
Yeah, look, it actually came from Paul Roos, who was the coach of the Sydney Swans AFL team. Okay. And he had the No Dickheads policy, and it was very successful. And essentially what we're saying is the construction industry traditionally has a lot of egos. It has a lot of alpha males, a lot of table thumping and that sort of thing. And when we set up the company from scratch 5 years ago, we said we want to build a better way. We want to make it easier. We want to retain people. We want to have fun. And we don't have alpha males. Now, anyone who has behaved poorly, and I had one guy join us and he started talking about salaries. And I said to him, that's not okay. Your salary is your business and it's no one else's business. And he said to me, I need to go, don't I? He was in probation. And I said, yeah, you do. It's not how we behave. It's not in our values. And when he left, I got the staff together and we were only about 50 people at the time. I got them all together and I said, this is what happened. This is why he's leaving. That's not okay. 3 minutes, and one of the project engineers walked away and he said, that was the shortest and most effective training course I have ever been on. And so if you think about it with your children, there has to be a rule and a consequence. And if you don't have consequence and you keep walking past it, it becomes acceptable. And so what we're saying is it's not acceptable. And if you behave like that, you don't have a place in our organisation. And as I said, I've now got project team saying to me, hey, that's not okay. That's not how we behave. Can you take that person out? And it's not, you know, one strike and you're gone. For some things it is, the serious ones. But it's a conversation to say, do you think that's acceptable? No, it's not. Okay, well, can you change? If you can't change and you don't want to change, then perhaps you should find a job somewhere else. So it's just about, it's the decency piece. Be a decent person, treat people with respect. And if you're not if you're not going to buy into gender diversity, in diversity of all sorts, we have ages from 17 to 70, we're 35% culturally represented, we're 5% Indigenous, you don't have a place here. It's quite simple.
Thank you. Thank you, Alison. And another attendee has asked Stacey if you would be able to introduce such a policy at DPR.
So while I don't know that we would quite use the same vernacular, we absolutely, so I love it. We absolutely have policies in place around, again, cultivating a culture of inclusion and belonging and really standing up behaviors that will and will not be tolerated. And I think Alison said it brilliantly, and I mentioned it in my presentation, not everyone, we have to acknowledge that not everyone is prepared to be on this journey. And while I'm all for meeting people where they are, I'm also a firm believer in not staying there with them. And so as an organization, we have to recognize that within that framework, there are folks who will self-select themselves out. They will just say, this isn't the environment that I want to be in, and they will leave voluntarily. Others, as Alison so very politely put it, may have to be invited to do something elsewhere. And so we do have policies in place. We have employment expectations. And when people violate those, we look at it from a couple of perspectives. A, is it a teaching moment? Is it a teaching opportunity? Is there an opportunity to educate and inform? But also, is there an opportunity to invite those individuals to find employment elsewhere, depending on, you know, the level of the offense? So again, I will have to give some thought to the vernacular, but absolutely, we have some things in place to make clear what our expectations are around how we treat each other, not just with respect, but with dignity. I think respect is earned. Dignity is a human condition. Everyone should be treated with dignity.
Thank you, Stacey. So moving on from that vernacular, another question is, are there any project examples of a diverse workforce leading to a better outcome for the project? Would anyone like to take that first? Sandy, perhaps.
Well, I hesitate to talk about historic stuff, but I think it's important to recognise there have been beacons of light over time. What concerns me is how we turn these wonderful case studies or examples into the norm. You know, I remember once when I was citing a really forward-looking company that had fantastic policies and great culture, and the reaction from others was, oh, well, it's them, they're different. And I think we have an issue, I think, in the industry of converting the different and the disruptive into, so why don't we all do it? But back to the question, yes, there was an example of a power station where, rather like the wonderful stuff that Alison was doing, the organization sat down and said, how are we going to deliver this project in a decent and fair way? It's a remote site. These people, and they were all men at that point, these men aren't going to see their families for weeks. And that's not right. And they recalibrated the project in order to give that far better on-site working experience. And it did deliver to time and to budget. And actually, can I just sneak in a quick question to Alison? When you said about it taking 10 weeks longer, I assume you had a client that wasn't operating to time of the essence philosophy. So they were happy with the extended contract time you were providing.
Yes, and it's government. It was a hospital, so they were okay. It was a hospital extension. And I get this question a lot. Now, Concord was a pilot. What we learned was that we got increased productivity, so we're actually not adding any time anymore. Mm. But the other thing that we need to remember is people are dying from suicide. If I put in my tender and I said my price is $100 million, it'll take 24 months and I'll kill three people, there's not a client in the world that would accept that I know of. But that is the reality of what we are doing in the industry by how we are pushing jobs. And that's not okay. And so if we need to slow down, then that's what we need to do. Now, the reality is we've got increased productivity, so it's not adding any extra time anymore. But we've got to move past the concept of it's cost a bit more or it's taken a bit longer. If you have a fatality on site, it will add an inordinate amount of time to your program. So the good thing was from the pilot, the client was so supportive of it. They bought into it 100%. They were a brilliant client to do the project with. But we saw increased productivity because they rested.
Yes, fantastic. And that brings in the really important issue around client and good procurement practice. And yes, the building in of the value and the social value and the impact. And you're spot on. Mention the word death, and it's quite difficult to accept a shorter time frame and a lower cost if there is a loss of life. Thank you.
I wonder, Sandy, could I ask you, with you, you've got a good broad view of the industry. Is it too soon to say that companies who grapple with this seriously start to enjoy a competitive advantage?
I think we are getting there. I think it is more encouraging now than it's ever been. And I think it's a combination of factors that were both predicted and the unpredicted. There's no doubt that COVID has had a dramatic change on the working environment, which will impact on many people. I think the point Caroline was making about this huge skill shortage, and we've been talking about skill shortages now for many years, and it's still sitting there, the elephant in the room. I think there is an issue about reaching out to the people who have influence on recruiting staff. And when staff recruitment and skills recruitment becomes a huge problem for companies, they then have to start taking action. And there's a huge area there in terms of the rewards of the industry. And so parents who have an amazing impact on influence on the choice of young people, who for a long time said, well, no, I don't want you to go into construction. Why do you think I drive a taxi or change? It was because in the last recession, I lost my job and it's unreliable. I think we have a job to do, which companies can now take off, which is saying there are so many routes into success in this industry that you can work in parallel career paths, that there is work, there is opportunity, and there are companies who are giving decent working conditions, exactly the decent working conditions for people. So I think there's an economic imperative, Rod, which I think must cut through. But I think it's really important for the industry to talk to the right people to share that, because it does tend to talk to itself. So reaching out in community, Stacey, you were talking about community. You know, the community understands and knows what you do, and that will lead on to, well, I wouldn't mind working there. And then that leads to, and it's a really good company, and other companies see, and they either have to poach your people or they have to stand up and be counted and actually change their perceptions. So I'm more encouraged than I've been for some time in terms of these different influences. Economic, I think the sustainable issue is a very powerful one. Young people want to make a difference to their environment. So that is another good route into the industry. And I think there's an economic imperative, but there are some plus points there. So I think it's better. And people want to talk about it now. That's the huge difference. I love the dickheads thing. I think absolutely right. And just one practical thing on that. There's often a lot of talk about, oh, there are more women in the industry at non-exec level, and somehow that doesn't count. And the latest figures that came out in the UK today, which was there's been a big increase in the number of women on the boards of FTSE 250 companies. And the reaction very often is, oh, well, they're only non-execs. Now, use your non-exec. It's the non-exec who can say in that boardroom meeting, why am I sitting in a room of pale, male and stale? You know, what are we doing in this business and how can we help? So I think there are some, we should carry on working at getting more women at executive level, and this is where we get into the retention pipeline. If they're not there, we can't promote them to executive, senior executive level. But at the same time, why don't you make more use of the ones who are there and help them? Because it's easier often for a board to listen to a critical friend than it is to listen to somebody else who may have a different agenda. Mm-hmm. And I think we could perhaps take that opportunity to drive change within an organisation that makes a difference.
A couple of other questions to lead on to. Somebody has asked about how we persuade clients to enforce diversity more when they award construction contracts. And Stacey and Alison, somebody has asked if there are laws around procurement in the US and Australia that compel contractors to employ a diverse workforce. Would you like to just say a little bit about that, Alison, first?
We are starting to see diversity schedules in tenders now. For the advanced clients, we are starting to see that where you need to have an answer to how you will promote gender and cultural and age diversity. In terms of, what was the next question?
The first question was really about how you encourage clients to enforce a sort of diverse policy in appointing contractors, but then whether that can be enshrined in law or if it is enshrined in law anywhere.
So it's not in law at the moment. The state of Victoria has just introduced a gender equality bill or act. It's for the construction industry. It has targets in it that you need to meet. It doesn't come into full force for 2 years. To give the industry time to get ready and to understand what they need to do. But it's the first one that's come in and it's fantastic. In New South Wales, the government has recently been working with industry to develop a culture standard for the industry and it's just gone into consultation. It has three pillars to it. So the first one is putting the health back in WHS. Everyone shouts safety but whispers health. The second one is time for life, working 5 days a week, less than 50 hours a week. And the third one is gender. And it's not to say that we're not focused on all forms of diversity. Let's tackle the 50% first, and then we'll go through all the other forms of diversity. But if you can get more women on site, you get more inclusion, and that then comes with a whole lot of other benefits for other forms of diversity. So that's in consultation at the moment, and the idea is that that will go through all government projects. So it's not in yet, but there are plans to bring it in.
Interesting, thank you. Stacey, do you want to give the US perspective?
Absolutely. So if it's a government contract, then there are laws in place regarding a percentage of the dollar value being designated towards the supplier diversity procurement side being allocated. And there's some wording around good faith efforts because some of it depends on some geographical constraints that might exist in terms of access to diverse businesses, diverse minority-owned businesses. But more and more, even in our non-governmental contracts, our clients are asking the question, you know, what percentage is going to go to supplier diversity? What is your internal DEI representation? So we're seeing it more and more on our RFPs and RFQs where clients are, not only are we endeavoring to volunteer that information, but they are asking that information more and more. What's your representation? How are you going to support workforce development within the community? And what are your policies, practices, procedures that you have in place to increase diversity and representation?
Thank you, Stacey. Another question is, are there any sectors that construction can learn from on diversity? Caroline, would you like to offer some perspective on that?
Thank you. Well, my background is manufacturing, engineering manufacturing, And in the same way that I would suggest manufacturing engineering are light years ahead on their attitude and behaviours, cultures towards quality and safety, I suggest it is also, it has been the same with diversity and inclusion. Probably the gap isn't as great as with safety and quality, but I think they've got some great research. They've done some great things, and I think it's pretty much there now in manufacturing generally. And I'm talking with a UK lens, to be quite honest with you. And I think we need to remember the companies, the countries that we've got represented here today. I think we're quite a long way on our journeys. I've just come back from the Middle East again in the last few months. And, you know, I'm still visiting labor camps where the issues, the subjects that we're talking about are workers' rights. How much sleep do they get? What are the temperatures are they working in? What's the food quality? What contact do they have with their families? So we are not yet equal around the globe. So it's really, really important events like this. We're sharing what Alison and Stacey can teach us and give us live examples. But we need to remember there are some people in the Middle East working in conditions, they're dying at night of a heart attack because they're working in heat, they're not getting enough fluids, and those statistics are not being counted as worker deaths, they're going down as natural causes. So I think, you know, there is just so much to do in this space across all the spectrums. But sorry, to go back to your original question, I think engineering and manufacturing, I also think our education establishments, from my observations of them, are doing a pretty good job. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Caroline. One other question, going back to Alison and Stacey again. The question is whether you think that your policies have given you an edge when it comes to bidding for contracts. Alison, if you want to go first.
Absolutely. Definitely has. And it's a joy to be able to write in our tenders that we've got a 35% or 40% site team being offered to clients. We work with a lot of the institutional clients, and they all have gender targets. They all have equality policies, and for them it's not just in their organization, it's through their supply chain as well. So yes is the short answer, definitely.
And Stacey?
Yes. I'll just plus one to everything Alison just said. It absolutely is a competitive advantage, and it's necessary. It's absolutely necessary.
Okay. Now, can I ask something, Bill? Alison, the Concord Hospital, have you repeated the 5 day a week model with other projects?
Yes, I had. At the same time we were building Concord Hospital, we also did an enabling works package at Liverpool Hospital. So it was about 20 million. Concord Hospital was about 225. We are building a hotel at the moment for a private client, and that's working 5 days a week, a 301 room Moxie hotel. That Marriott will operate. And we are just about to start a school for Department of School Infrastructure, Government Department in New South Wales, and that's 5 days a week as well. So now when we're tendering, we actually only put in 5 day program. I don't give clients a choice on six anymore because it's the same time. And, you know, clients don't work 6 days a week. So why shouldn't my guys and girls work 6 days a week? So same time, better conditions, better outcome, better productivity, better harmony, better quality, win-win. So yes, we do have other projects.
Great.
Thank you. I think that is pretty much all the questions from the attendees. So before we wrap up, I'll go around the panel for final thoughts on what we've heard today. Caroline, would you like to start?
Well, I'm sorry, Alison, I'm probably going to steal something that you've said earlier, but I really do believe this. It's about, as a leader, creating a workplace where people, the staff, can call out bad behaviours and feel safe and supported in doing so. So I'm going to take that one. Thank you.
Thank you. Alison. Just some final thoughts on today.
Look, my advice to everyone is talk about the issues, put it front and centre, don't hide it, and be brave. You know, making change is hard, and you need to make sure you've got some allies around you, because there are some people who get terrified of the change. But it's not change for us here and now. It's change for the generations that will follow in our footsteps. So it's worth it. And when I have a bad day or I'm feeling a bit down, I go out to site and I see the joy on our people's faces and I think, yep, this is right. So please talk about it. And it's not a women's issue, it's a people issue. We need to change the working conditions for men and women will benefit.
Thank you, Alison. Stacey.
Well, what's the saying? A rising tide raises all ships. So I love what you say, Alison. It's not just a women's issue. It's a people issue. And the other two quotes I mentioned earlier is that we don't rise to the level of our goals. We fall to the levels of our systems. It's so important to have those policies, the procedures, the transparency in place to hold ourselves and others accountable. And a company's culture is the worst behavior a leader is willing to tolerate. So all of those things that tend to go, you know, the things that are really obvious, but it's the things that's the microaggressions, it's the unconscious bias, it's the psychological safety that we really need to be paying attention to. So I would just encourage, if it was easy, everyone would be doing it. We'd flip a switch and the world would be a better place. We'd all be better humans. We've got to be willing to put in that work. The payoff at the end will be so much better, not just for companies, but for literally humanity. I mean, this is the work of the human condition and having the world be a better place for everyone.
Thank you, Stacey. And Sandy, some final thoughts from you.
Well, I think everybody's said just about everything, but I think what's come clear from what we've heard today is we need to carry on daring to be different. It's you need the courage. So dare to be different, be determined, be disruptive, and in your back pocket, always have those hard facts. Hard facts with a sense of humour so that you can cut through when you deliver it. You know, keeping a sense of humour really is important in our industry, but having the data is important. So different, determined, disruptive, and informed. Those are my final words.
Great. Okay. I'm going to wrap things up there with some concluding comments. Just to say thank you very much to all our speakers and panellists for their time and insights this morning. Alison Mirams, Stacey Barkley, Caroline Gumble, Sandy Rhys-Jones, and Rod Sweet. Just to say, this webinar will be available on demand, and you can find more information on the rest of the Global Construction Summit at that URL, globalconstructionreview.com/global-construction/summit. And obviously, GCR is where you can find out all the latest global construction news. Our next session in the Global Construction Summit is this afternoon. That's Building Safety and Technology Around the World. And that is at 2 p.m. and that is Greenwich Mean Time, in association with Plan Radar. But now, thanks once again to our speakers, and thank you to everyone who has tuned in, and enjoy the rest of your day.
Hi, everybody.
Bye.
Thank you. Bye.